welcome to my first ever blog. I'm Scorch, if you didn't know. Basically, I'm going to be releasing a new blog every week, highlighting some of the things that, you know, we do here at ScorchTV. In this particular blog, we're going to go over some things dealing with the car, the ScorchTV chase car. We just got back from the track. We ran eights right off the trailer on 10 pounds. If you haven't seen that video yet, click up here and it'll show you. So we'll get right into it, show you some of the things that we learned, some of the things that we're about to upgrade, and I have it laid out right here. So first of all, being that it is a turbo engine, we're generating a lot of heat, a lot of oil heat in particular. So we went ahead and got a B&M oil cooler with the fan, and it's actually the same oil cooler that I have running on my transmission, my power glide, and it keeps things at a cool 150 degrees running on the highway. So I know that this is going to work perfect. Another thing, because it is an oil cooler and it's dealing with oil, and the oil still needs to get up to operating temperature rather quickly, it's utilizing a 170 stat temperature sensor. So once the engine reads 170, it'll be able to turn on the fan to regulate it from there on. And being that we're not going through the radiator or the current placement of the oil cooler that I have on the car now, which you'll see, this will help keep everything nice and cold, including the coolant, since we won't be mixing the two together in the radiator. So this one will go behind the driver's side fog light area, and on the other side, behind the fog light area on the passenger side, is the trans cooler. So it should look pretty neat and work, which is all I'm concerned with. Secondly, is just a gripe to me, is dealing with changing the wheels. As if you follow the car, I have two different sets of wheels. One is a regular 15 inch, 15 by 10, 6.5 backspace weld RTS, and with that, when you run 15s, at least these, you have to use a shank lug nut. And normally people get the weld racing ones, which are pretty cheap, and it's just a two-piece. One is a washer and one is a regular shank lug nut. The issue that I run, or my gripe, is that every time I go to swap wheels, I have to rotate the wheel until I get the lug nut perfectly on with the washer and so forth. And then after a couple of uses, if you take the wheel on and off a lot, it starts gouging into the washer itself. And it just becomes kind of an issue. So instead, I went ahead and got the Champion Beadlock lug nuts. They're actually a lot lighter. They're stronger. And it's a one-piece design, and they look pretty damn cool. So this is the comparison. Okay. Then, as you have noticed in the vid that you would have clicked on, I was having some pretty big issues at the track with the toe deflection that I was experiencing, because what happens is when you launch, the bushings that are holding the lower and upper A-arms together to the chassis itself, to the subframe, are rubber, so they're flexing and causing the toe-in condition, which in turn then makes you lose traction or gives you a very unstable feeling, even at high speeds. So in light of that, we contacted our friends over at LG Motorsports, and they sent us their monoblock kit, which is basically a billet housing, in which replaces the stock rubber bushings that were never meant to take this type of thing on. So basically, you squeeze the other ones out, which is easier said than done, and you replace it with this. It goes on, C-clip, done. No more issues with that. So we'll be performing this modification later on. I'll try to get some footage of that so you guys can see that. I'll definitely get some of the oil cooler install so you guys can see how I'm doing that. And right now we're just gonna go outside and actually take the car off the trailer and put her up in the air and start the modifications. Now, remember, the car is a street car. I just don't take my chances by not driving it all the way to the track. Besides the fact that it rained. Let's go. So it's about 10:50 on Monday night, and by an hour I have to load up the car and start my way up to Indiana to RPM Transmissions. On Sunday, taking the car apart as I usually do, making sure that everything's still good and doing my usual checks for consist of checking spark plugs. Even after the track, I take them out, cut them. Look into the porcelain, look at the color band, etc. everything looks good engine wise. On the transmission drivetrain side, I discovered some things that we need to adjust, and for that I depend on them to do what they do best. So I'm gonna be making the track up there, and hopefully they can give me a hand with some of the things that we need to adjust before some of the major events coming up. Another thing is, right now, the car is obviously a 434 RHS Black, NAS heads, twin turbo, 68, 70 millimeter precision turbos. at 10 pounds, it's probably a little over 1,000 horsepower. we're running E85 and a little bit of meth on top of that. And because of that, we're running BR7 plugs, NGKs, gapped at 20. So after looking at the plugs that we have in the car, we figured about 14 pounds is as much as they can take. We're currently running BR7s, NGKs, and we have them gapped at around 20, and we're getting some spark blowout once we try to pass over 15 or so. So we're going to be switching over to B8EFs. It's a non-resistor plug, so we'll see how those work out. And we're going to gap these around 15 in hopes that we can run about 25, 29 pounds or so. Once we do some test hits and stuff and see what the plugs look like, we'll actually cut them open to be able to look deep inside and see how everything looks. as well as looking at the strap and the color and so forth to give us a good indication of how the motor is going. Usually, even after I take them out, I'll stick a little camera inside the cylinders to check out the pistons, check out the walls, look how everything, look at how everything looks, and make sure everything's good to go still. Obviously, when running something of this nature, this much power, stuff is gonna always go at one point or another, no matter how badass you build stuff. So I like to take precautionary measures just to make sure that I know if something's happening or not with this engine, especially if you run it on a daily basis, whether it be just driving around the block or whatever. I like to keep things as safe as possible. So if we figure out that this doesn't run well with the B8 plug, we're going to go to a 10 range plug and see how it pans out then, and so forth. Obviously, when you're tuning, you just can't go off of your wideband and so forth. The plugs are going to be the tell-all as to what's going on inside the engine, how your mixture's looking, if you're getting any detonation, and if the spark range is, if the cold range is a good mix for what you're doing. So we'll see. So we're going to gap these, put it back in the car, put the car back together in less than 30 minutes, hopefully, and load it up on the trailer, and then leave from here in about an hour or so to get down there in time by the open, and then get things going. So as you can see, this is usually where I work on the videos and everything, the office. The cameras are behind that camera. This is my normal editing. This is my Mac for all the Final Cut Pro editing. This is normally a one-man show. So if you guys are thinking that, you know, ScorchTV is made up of a bunch of people, it is. They help me where they can. But for the most part, it's me trying to do a car, trying to do my normal life, because this is a hobby, and trying to edit videos and capture videos at the same time. So I get a lot of help from a lot of people at times, but for the most part, it's just solo dolo. I'll be doing probably a blog every week or so, and try to release it the next week if possible, just to give you guys an insight into what it takes to have a car of this level, this much maintenance, and you know, it's a streetable car. I try to drive it every day if I can. Obviously, the weather doesn't cooperate sometimes. And then aside from that, just trying to balance doing my own personal car stuff and trying to run a, you know, Facebook page and edit videos and attend events and, you know, answer a bunch of questions from people who contact me some way or another to, you know, gain some knowledge and so forth. So I always encourage you, if you watch these videos, when I start doing these blogs and stuff, please post up if you have any questions, if you want me to talk about something, if you got any specific questions regarding the car, the editing I do, you know, the history of how I got started with all this. I would be happy to answer your question in the vlog. So, thank you. Okay, it's about 7:30 a.m. the next day. I've officially been up for 26 hours straight. I'm about to unload the car. It's back there. And let them do their thing, RPM transmissions. And then load it back up and head back home. I'm going to take the longest nap ever here now. And then start all over again, doing some test hits and so forth, and see how everything works out. Update y'all in a few. I think we're on. All right. So you can see the trailer is now parked. The car is parked. I'm gonna take it for a quick ride. I don't even know what time it is. It is 8:19 in the evening. Just got back from RPM. Now, what did we learn? We learned not to do hard launches while we still have a toe deflection issue. And we learned that this little piece is gonna save us some heartache from trying to launch and everything bending and twisting, such as a 3/4-inch steel plate or close to it. So we're gonna do that piece tomorrow. I'm gonna take off the A-arms. I'm gonna take it to the machine shop because I don't wanna deal with that. And we're gonna get her ready to go. I am in the middle of maybe trying to put some AFCO coilovers on it to give myself better control on the launch and even at high speeds, as I would probably the same as I have a tune just for the track with the AMS. I have a tune to control the boost on the street that brings it on in a completely different manner. So I'll probably have the same done. Get some test hits done on the street, get some on the track, and write it down which one works best and be able to switch out pretty quick on the fly, depending on where we're at. So right now, I'm gonna go drive the car real quick, then go sleep for the next 3 days straight, because I'm tired. No, that's impossible. So I'm gonna take a nap, get back up, finish the pumping video, and also Jim Brandon's bet, and release that footage for everyone. And then just get ready for the next event, which will be SCT St. Louis. And yeah, I think that's about it. Thanks. Okay, just got done taking this all apart. It's gonna be a pain in the butt to get all this stuff off and make sure that it's clearance good enough for the other ones to go in. I'm about to go take it to the machinist and see if he can get this done. If not, I'll send it off to LG overnight, and hopefully I get it done in the day and send it back overnight. So yeah, that's for right now. Once I drop this off, I'll be back and I'll start the oil cooler. Yeah, I'll start the oil cooler install. I'll get that done. And then we'll hopefully get the car back together. I'm still trying to figure out the suspension deal, where my options are either try to get some custom AFCOs done, double adjustable coilovers for the front and back, or spend big money and go Penske, double adjustables, or wait until I got everything mapped out and just do some QA1 double adjustable shocks in the back like I have in the front and see how that works out. The goal is to go 1.1 anything 60 foot, as well as get it to hook really well on power on the street. So we'll see how that goes. So now it's Saturday. I got the lower upper A-arms, the rears, done with the bushings. I'll be showing those in a few. I am in the middle of installing the new oil cooler, and I'm gonna be putting it approximately here, which is about the same that I have on the other side of the transmission cooler. So I'll be reusing part of the stock oil cooler lines that come on some of the LS build motors, such as the LS7 and so forth. And then I'll be doing a crimp connection there and going to the cooler via a dash 10 line from there. I think the stock line is about a dash 8, so it shouldn't be too bad. Then I also ordered some Mentor AFCO custom coilovers to go on the front and the back. Those should be here Tuesday. I also have a and this is what happens when you order too much stuff or got too much stuff going on. A D3 fan shroud that will help keep everything cool. Right now the car runs at about 200 degrees Fahrenheit, coolant temperature wise, and about 200 as well, oil cooler wise. What I want to do is get it down to around a 170 range on both sides and be able to keep it there after, you know, back-to-back runs and so forth. I also have new meth nozzles coming in, two M2 nozzles, so that I can turn the controller up and not have it set at 2, but also I don't need much. I'm just controlling the IATs with it since we're running E85. And that's about it. We're draining the oil right now and about to start mocking up a bracket or something to hold this thing up, and then work on the wiring, which I already pre-did, which is pretty easy. Always solder your connections. Always make sure they're away from heat. Just normal stuff. Make sure that your fuse is enough to hold whatever this is gonna pull. Make sure that the relay is enough amps to what this is gonna pull, and everything should be pretty easy. And the hardest part is usually just mounting it and making sure it looks okay. So yeah, that's, I believe it's about it. I'm gonna have somebody come over later, a machinist, and look and see if he can make me a tubular K number for the front, so that I can have more space to work around with the turbos and stuff. And if that gets accomplished, then I can put some air filters on it, because currently I have no air filters on the turbos because there's just not enough space there to pick. And that's about it. All right, so now we're just about ready to install the external oil cooler. Had some issues converting the tube lines to AM fittings, but we got that sorted out. So I made a couple custom lines. Already made the boundary bracket for it. So we're just gonna slide it in place, bolt it in, pre-bolt the lines, because we won't have room to bolt them in or screw them on once the cooler's in. And then I'll plug in the wiring already created. The one thing with this is that you gotta make sure that the in coming out of the engine or transmission goes to the part that the sensor is on, because if you do it backwards, the fan will never turn on. So I mark the line, make sure that it goes to where the sensor's at, and stick it in there. Then we finally got our coilovers from Mentor Motorsports. These are AFCO based with Mentor valving for our specific setup. So we corner weighted the car and made sure that the springs and everything else was suitable for what we're doing. They are both double adjustable, which means there is a knob for compression at the bottom or the top, I forget, and top up here. So once these are installed, we'll be able to dial in the car exactly how it needs to be in order to operate exactly how we want it at the track and the street. We also did double adjustables in the rear as well, and with the remote canister, this is going to allow us to really tailor the car at the rear end and how it launches. The reason that I didn't keep trying for a lower number my last track outing, and I only did 10 pounds and so forth, was to collect data and see how the rear end was behaving. Based on what we saw, which was just excessive toe movement or deflection, so to speak, we got the LG bushings on. Let me bring those over here. I'll bring one set. Basically, we got the bushings in, so these are good to go. I gotta put the C-clip in there to hold these in. But these are a lot more solid. Another thing I need to address now is the fact that these mount just fine, just as stock. There's nothing that attaches to it as far as the bracket is concerned. Now for the rears, as you can see, you did notice when I held these up, they don't come with a bracket. So what they expect you to do is utilize the stock bracket. Well, based on what one of my friends said and some more research online, the brackets themselves seem to bend. So the solution for that is to either get something milled out that's a little bit thicker, sturdier, or go with a billet mount of some sort. I don't have enough time right now. SCT is Friday. It is now Tuesday. So I'm kind of in a rush. I gotta finish up the oil cooler. I gotta install these. My only gripe with coilovers is that you have to keep adjusting the right height until you get it perfect. So it's a constant lower the car, check it, roll it, make sure that the suspension is settled, see how everything is measured out on level ground, and then if it's not right, lift it back up. And if you own a Corvette, you know how much of a pain that is. But for these, I'm gonna do a base height and then work my way up from there, but I'm gonna have them up pretty high if possible to help keep the car a little up off the ground, because if I lower it too much, the 28 inch tires in the back rub pretty hard on the liners, and then I have pipes running under the front of the car. So I have to give it a little bit of a rake look, because I like to keep the front of the car higher than normal, so the back of the car has to match that as well. And then once we go and test it, we'll see. I'm hoping for right off the gate with some of the settings that I mapped out based on the videos I saw and so forth of what we need to have and how I'm trying to launch the car, that we'll be able to get a 1-2-60 foot, hopefully, and work our way down to 1-1-60 foot. And that's it. I will make another video once this is all done. Again, this is my first vlog ever, so please, you know, give me constructive criticism, or if you have questions, or if you want to see something else on the next video, I'll be glad to try to do that. And yeah, that's it. Appreciate it. Appreciate your time, and thank you for subscribing, and hope to see you soon.